there's a whistleblower from the CDC who's going to come out and say that the CDC had committed fraud on the MMR study and that they knew that vaccines were actually causing autism.
One of the great health controversies of the 21st century is the rise of autism in children. The vaccine as cause debate had died down until recently.
But definitely there's something to that movie. And there's a lot of information about things that are happening with the CDC, the pharmaceutical companies. There's a lot of things that are not said. I, as a parent of a child who has autism, I'm concerned. And I
want the film Vaxxed, which was to have debuted at the most recent Tribeca Film Festival, focuses on autism and vaccine safety. Due to its controversial nature, the movie was pulled from Tribeca at the last moment.
It bothered me because the implication was that if you had any skepticism whatsoever, you were anti-science.
And a kook.
And exactly. And I think there's a difference between having skepticism about science and having skepticism about the pharmaceutical industry.
And flying under the radar, but perhaps no less controversial, is this.
And a new study is raising concerns about a possible link between autism and antidepressants.
Late last year, the Journal of the American Medical Association published a study linking autism in children to their mothers taking SSRI antidepressants during pregnancy. Dr. Annick Berard, a Canadian epidemiologist, is an author of the study.
And we continue learning about antidepressant exposure during pregnancy. So if you use these types of medication in late pregnancy, you double your risk of having a child with autism.
And they did in fact find an association between women who took antidepressants in the second and third trimester and an increased relative risk of about 87% of having a child with autism spectrum disorder.
Because after looking at what happens right after delivery, we want to know what happens later on in children.
But some in the medical profession and the media are skeptical. One journalist calling it another misguided panic about autism, which may explain why such a study will have a difficult time finding its way into a courtroom.
Any study that shows an association between an exposure to something and a very serious condition has to be looked at. Now, I think this particular study is a long way from being the basis of lawsuits or any sort of mass litigation alleging that SSRIs cause autism.
Because every case attempting to prove a drug injury needs an expert. But experts can be challenged before a trial even starts. Not only their credentials, but their methods, too. Under strict standards set down by two landmark cases, known as Daubert and Fry, the road is a tough one for a plaintiff's experts.
In the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, we're seeing greater certainty with regard to the standard, the admissibility of expert testimony. And that acts as a very effective filter on junk cases.
Junk cases to some, denial of justice to others. And Berard has seen this before. Last year, a Pennsylvania judge barred her from testifying on her Zoloft birth defects study. Now the Zoloft mass tort litigation is in shambles.
She's probably the foremost expert on this topic, but she was excluded from that case because the judge found that her methodology was unreliable. And there are judges that say, look, unless you can show a relative risk of double what's normal, your expert's not reliable. This is not science, really, but it's a problem that the law has to deal with.
The conclusions drawn by the Journal of the American Medical Association don't pull any punches. It shows a link between women who take antidepressants while pregnant and children born with autism. The problem is courts don't always adapt the newest wave in science, meaning these trials can be won or lost based on who the court deems is an expert. For the American Law Journal, I'm Gina Passarella.